okay, let's try to put all these pieces together now and talk about how sex occurs in flowering plants. Here's again my whole life cycle of a flowering plant, going from one sexually mature individual through meiosis, through to the making of gametes and fertilization, that fertilization then growing up into a new baby that will eventually become a sexually mature adult. So let's talk about each of these different steps. We've talked about what makes up a flower. A flower forms from a bit of meristematic bud that then undergoes making those four different zones of material that then grows up into being a perfect flower. Within the ovary, we have the production of the female gametophyte, and within the anther, we have the production of pollen grains or the male gametophyte. Those gametophytes then have to actually make gametes and come together, and that occurs through pollination. Pollen grains are taken from one flower to another flower where it can then find its way down to the egg. So what constitutes pollination? Well, it doesn't have to involve an animal. It can involve wind or water, but usually it involves some sort of active helper that actually takes pollen from one flower to the other, and these are usually insects or birds or bees. There's bat-pollinated flowers, and there's even some evidence for lizard-pollinated flowers. So all sorts of different animals can be used as pollinators. Different flowers want to make sure that their animal helpers will go from one of their flowers fairly directly to another individual of the same species. And they do that by actually advertising to those different pollinators how good and yummy they are. Remember when you read about tulips that talked about how tulips might appeal to their pollinators by being very symmetrical or offering different kinds of rewards. And different flowers try to appeal to different kinds of pollinators and also make those pollinators happy with the kinds of rewards they've gotten, so that they'll go from one individual of that species immediately to another individual of those species so that it can keep getting that reward. And that is what most efficiently moves pollen from one individual to another individual, to allow that cross-pollination that produces a healthy sexually produced zygote. So what are these different types of attractiveness, or different kinds of ways that different flowers attract different kinds of pollinators? Well, here's three different kinds of pollinators, and these are the different, what we call, pollination syndromes associated with those different kinds of pollinators, the different traits that we find together in the flowers that are serviced by different pollinators. So in flowers that are serviced by flies, we tend to get flowers that are really stinky. They generally smell like either rotting flesh or poop. Not exactly something I would want to get a bouquet of. This is an example of a carrion flower that, as you may guess, smells like rotting flesh, smells like carrion. And that's very attractive to flies who normally eat rotting flesh and so are attracted, thinking that it's going to be a food source, get covered in pollen while they're there. They get a little frustrated and they move on to what they hope is another piece of meat, which is actually another strongly smelling carrion flower. So in this case, they usually don't get the kinds of rewards that they might be expecting, and instead are getting tricked into going from one flower to the next. On the other hand, we have a beautiful flower here that's being pollinated by a hummingbird. And the types of flowers that hummingbirds tend to like are long, trumpet-shaped yellow or red flowers that are very showy. Hummingbirds are very good at detecting red and yellow in their environment and will fly from one group of flowers to another. They like the long trumpet because it keeps other insects from being able to get to the nectar inside, leaving it for them because their beaks are nice and long and skinny and able to probe into the center of those flowers and get its reward. On the other hand, bumblebees like flowers that are often kind of purple or blue, and often have UV markings if we look at them under ultraviolet light. They often also like copious amounts of pollen because they eat some of the pollen as well as distribute it, the pollen, to new flowers. So these are called pollination syndromes, and you can see how they're associated with different suites of characteristics that alert different pollinators that they're going to get their favorite types of rewards. pollination syndromes can actually lead to speciation. This is then a example that is ongoing research by a woman named Candy Galen, who I happen to know, who is working on this speciation event that seems to be occurring out in Colorado. That's where she does her study, in Colorado, here in North America. And she works on a plant that's called Alpine Sky Pilot. And she noticed, as she went up some of the mountains where this occurs, is that below the timberline, the flowers are small and they smell kind of skunky. And if you go above the timberline, the flowers are larger and they smell sweet. And she also noticed that you don't get flies up above the timberline. It's too windy up there and too cold, and they actually can't move around, whereas bumblebees are a little larger and a little more fearless flyers, and they will continue to pollinate flowers up above the timberline. This means that the flowers up here are trying to appeal to bumblebees, and that's why they've gotten larger and are sweeter smelling, whereas below the timberline, flies are much more prevalent, and so the flowers there are trying to appeal to flies, as their pollinators have that skunky smell that flies like, and are smaller because to flies they're still plenty big and showy. This means that even though these guys are genetically very similar, she's shown that these guys are still one population, they still swap pollen occasionally. The amount of cross-pollination between these two types is getting smaller and smaller, and offspring from crosses that are between the big sweet-smelling ones and the small skunky-smelling ones don't do well because they don't appeal to either pollinator, meaning that these guys are becoming more and more genetically isolated from each other and will eventually turn into new species. So we can see how appealing to different pollinators can cause a speciation event, cause one individual species to differentiate into two new species. Once pollination has occurred, that's actually when sperm is formed. So the little pollen grain here, remember it had all of two cells, one of those cells is going to divide and form two pollen grains, and the other cell is going to turn into what's called a pollen tube. And here you can see the pollen grain, it's germinated, as they say, which means that its pollen tube is growing downwards. That's the nucleus of the pollen tube cell. It's going to keep turning into one great big long cell, and within that cell the sperm nuclei follow behind the pollen nucleus. Okay, so here's the sperm on top of a carpel in a female flower, and it grows its way down to the egg. Here's an actual micrograph of this occurring. This is a stigma and style here that's been cut through, and the pollen grains have been stained with fluorescent dye so you can see them. Here's the pollen grains, and here's their germinated pollen tube racing each other down towards those eggs, pulling the sperm back behind them. Once the sperm gets down to the bottom, both sperm get to pollinate, but only one of them gets to be the baby's daddy. Why? Because fertilization in plants is called double fertilization. Inside of the ovary, the female gametophyte has formed an egg, but she also has a couple nuclei left over called the polar nuclei. As the pollen tube grows down, it's got two sperm in there. One sperm gets to fertilize the egg, which will turn into the zygote, and the other one fertilizes the polar nuclei to form this weird triploid tissue. The zygote, two alleles for every gene, one from mom and one from dad. The fertilization event here forms stuff called endosperm, and it has three alleles for every gene, two from mom and one from dad. This material here is going to turn into a yummy lunch for the baby to use as it grows. So there's a double fertilization event. One sperm gets to be the baby daddy, the other sperm gets to be lunch. You can see that double fertilization in seeds. What we have here is a wheat seed, and it has three parts to it. Starting from the outside, it has a seed coat on the outside. That seed coat comes from mom and is diploid tissue, has the same two alleles for every gene that she has in the rest of her body. Okay. As we go inside of that seed coat, there's two big parts of the seed. There's the embryo, which is going to turn into the baby plant, the part that grows and turns into a seedling and then into an adult plant. That embryo is diploid material, or 2N as we like to say. It has two alleles for every gene, one from mom and one from dad. The other part of the seed is the endosperm. The endosperm is material that's going to be eaten by the embryo as it starts to grow when it germinates and starts to turn into a seedling. Endosperm material is the product of that second fertilization, and it has three alleles for every gene. We call this triploid, or 3N. Two alleles came from mom and one came from dad. The endosperm in a wheat seed like this is the part of the seed that we actually grind up to make flour from. If it is whole wheat flour, it includes the embryo, and if it's white flour, we've taken the embryo off and all that we are eating is the endosperm. So endosperm is a lot like white flour. It's very starchy, it's full of sugars, and it has lots of good caloric value for us. And it's made from this endosperm material that is incapable of being a zygote. It can't undergo mitosis very well because it's triploid material, which kind of makes it a little screwy, and it certainly can't undergo meiosis because it doesn't have just two homologous chromosomes to line up. So this endosperm material is an evolutionary dead end, which makes it good for eating and doesn't let it compete with the embryo. This is a diploid seed here. You can see the two little baby cotyledons here, which is how they get that dicot name, remember. And it still has the same three parts that our wheat seed had. It has a protective seed coat that is diploid, that comes from mom and has the same alleles as mom. Here's that nutritive tissue, which is also called endosperm, right? And remember, it's triploid. And then here's our embryo, diploid tissue, one allele from mom and one allele from dad, okay? So a seed has three parts: a baby with its lunch inside of a lunchbox, the embryo, the endosperm, and the seed coat. All right, what did we learn this time? We learned that asexual reproduction occurs via mitosis, while sexual reproduction occurs via meiosis. Most plants can do both ways of reproduction. Plants have two life stages, a diploid life stage and a haploid life stage, and this is also called alternation of generations. It has four parts to its flowers: sepals, petals, stamens, and carpels. Learn their names and start looking at the flowers around you and start pulling those flowers apart and seeing if you can find those four parts in flowers. We also learned a lot of vocabulary about what to call flowers that are missing parts to them, either incomplete or imperfect, depending on if the missing parts are sexual or not. We also learned how a plant reproduces, and this means not only undergoing meiosis to make that gametophyte, then also making the gamete. The gametes have to be spread by pollination. Fertilization has to occur, and then seed production. And there are many different parts to this long story, and this is the part that you'll probably want to practice in your head again and again. Remember all the parts of alternation of generation, of when you make those two sperm and how do they get to the egg, how different pollination syndromes work, how fertilization has two parts to it with double fertilization, and then the different parts of the seed that are then made from them. Okay? Good luck, and I'll see you next week.